Good morning, everyone. My name is Lam Liam, and today our webinar will be on the calibration tool in EEMS Explorer version 8.4. So the outline for the webinar today is including this contents. So firstly, it's the introduction. Sorry, and then I will have a quick description on the file formats that we can use, and some time series statistics. And the main focus of the webinar today is the working on the calibration tools, and the final is the question and answers. So during my presentations, if you have any questions or comments, you can raise your hands. You can also type in the Q&A panels, and our team will try to answer during the webinar, or we can wait to the Q&A sessions. So, and for the webinar today, we will have some example on the one model for the Halong Bay that is one of the UNESCO heritage sites. And this is the grid and the area of the model. So we have the World Heritage Site on the southern side of this model. And in this model, we have three small tributaries supply inflow into the area. We have the bay here. And in this area, we have some mining activities. We have a port here. We also have two thermal plants. One is here and the other is there, and several other industrial. And also we're going to have aquaculture for shrimp farming, and also mangroves, so many kind of activities. And this model, we will focus on hydrodynamics, including temperature and salinity. So for the model calibration, we will use different kind of data. So firstly, we have the station data. So we have one station, it's called by Chase station here. We can have a transect to compare the flow rates here. And we also have the cruise track here. So we have a boat or ship that traveling along this track and recording temperature and salinity, and how we compare the data from the check with the model, so that we will have some demonstration for that. And next, I will describe three different data formats for the data that we need to prepare for the calibration. So the first one is a very common one, is the time series format. So this data format in a text file, and here I copy to the Excel, so we can see there are a headers. So the first number is the number of the data points we have, and the name of the data series next. So, and there are two columns. One is for the time, and the second one is for the data value. And the time is normally it's in the Julian days since the base date. So normally is that the model base date. But you also accept that you can have a calendar date format in this time column. So that's very simple. So if you you can prepare this in Excel and then export or copy the data to a text file. And the next one, okay. Sorry. The next one is the data formats for a cruise check. So in this file formats, we will have a headers started with asterisk. So, and the rest is the data columns. We have five data columns. The first one, the first column is the time in Julian days. So similar to the time series format. So we can see that the time is changing when the boat is traveling along the track. And the second and the third columns are the X and Y coordinates. So the coordinate of the boat is changing also. And the fourth column is the water depth. So in this situation, we mount some sensor to the boat, and when it's traveling along the track, it can record the salinity and temperature at a different water depth with respect to the water surface elevation. So we may have similar time and X and Y coordinate here, but we may have a different depth. And here we have some salinity measure. So for other cap data like temperature and other transport constituents, we can also prepare the data format in this form. And EE also support the crew checks for the USGS format. And if you have the USGS, you want to have that, you can download the data from the USGS website and look at the format on that website. And you can load that into EE and for the calibration. And the third one is the format for the vertical profile. So in this file formats, we have the one line for the headers that some information about the location. And for each data record, we have three lines. So it starts with the number of data points here for, so this one is three data points. And we have the second value is the time when the profile is recorded. And then we have the headers followed by the two lines. One line is the depth points. So here we have the three depth points that are presenting the water depth. So we have 1 meter and 5 and 9 meters below the surface. And then the it's followed by the next slide, the temperature or some other data points for these water depths. And then we have the other record, it follows, and for each record, we have different data, can be the data, or it can be different. Okay, so next, we will move to the time series statistics. So when commonly when we compare the time series between the data and the model, we need some criteria or index to judge the model if it's good or bad to the data. And these are the different time series statistics. So we have the mean value of the observed data and model. Yeah. So O is indicated observed data, and P is predicted or computed by the model. So we have the mean value, the standard deviations. And we have also here the mean error. So that simply is the mean value from the model minus the mean value from the observed data. And we can have here, we can calculate the relative mean errors. So there are some different formula for that. So in this case, if we sometimes we use this denominator is the mean value of the observation, but you should keep in mind that for what the surface elevation in the coastal area, for example, that the mean observation might be very close to zero, so it's been reduced very large relative mean errors. So in this case, some people also not using the mean observation in the denominator, but they use the magnitude between the maximum and minimum of the observation with this situation. And the third one is the absolute mean error. So we can see this formula here. And one of the common error statistic is the root mean square errors. And we can see that the formula for that. And also people also can use the relative root mean square error also. And more error statistic that people can be can use that including the coefficient of the determination that it the square of the correction coefficient. So we have R square here, and the other one is the NAS subscript index of efficiency. And also these there are some type of the coefficient for the efficiency of the model or index of the agreement between the model and the data. And there are also some variation of the, this formula as well. And with EEMS Explorer 8.4, all of these statistics can be calculated. So with the, this form in PE, you can check which statistic you want to calculate. So by checking this, we have this here, and you can check on by clicking on this button. And you can have option to combine the error statistic as well. And if you want to generate the error statistic to a text file, you can check on this automatically generate report. And in the new version of 8.4, beside of the old report in the text table, that for each error statistic, we have one text file. But in this version, we also have the HTML format that we have only one table that including all the selected error statistic. And we will look at this. So here's the HTML format for the error statistic that for some the station we can see here. So we have a different column to present different type of statistics. Okay, so I will move to the main part with the working with the calibration tool. So some demonstration on the model calibration. So here we have some time series comparison between the model and the data for the water surface elevation, and this this example is taken from the Lake Washington model. So we can have this report, and sometime for we can have the plot settings that we can display in this the model is a solid line and the data as a dots. And for the vertical profile, it's also for the Lake of Washington, we can set up the data and model comparison, and EE can report and prepare this kind of plots to compare between the model as a solid blue line and the data as the red dots. So we can see that this is the sigma z model of the Lake Washington. So you can see that it's can produce very well the thermocline and the vertical variation of the temperature in the lakes. The lake is almost up 60 meter depth. And in EE, you can use other tool for the calibration purpose, like this one. This is the comparison of the longitudinal profile for the temperature along a tract along the lake. So we see, you can see that the sigma z model compared to the classical sigma z model that produce a very good thermocline and the vertical structure of the lake temperature. So now I can move to the demonstration of the So we now we will work on have some demonstration of the calibration tool. So when you load a model in EEMS.4, you can go to the navigate to the model analysis here, and in this tab you can see the different tool for different type model calibration. The first one is the time series comparison. So here we have in this area. As a second one, we can prepare the correlation plots. And in this area, we can set up the vertical profile comparisons. And in EEMS, you can also set up some very high frequency data extraction from the model for some certain periods. So in this area, you can set up this comparison for the high frequency output. And this one is for the comparison of the flux, like flow discharge. And the sixth one is the cruise plot comparison. And firstly, we will have some demonstration on the time series comparison. So when you want to define the time series comparison, we can click on the edit, define edit button here. So we click on this. And in this input form, you can specify the number of the time series you want to compare. For example, here we have three time series comparisons. So if I want to have four, I just type in the number four here. So, okay, so I go back and to get the X and Y coordinate for this. So I will go to the view 2D plan and select the point. For example, if I want to extract the data in the middle of the model at this location, so I click, mark click on this, and you will have the X and Y coordinate and information for the cell we just click on. So to copy this data to get the X and Y coordinate, so you can right click on this area, and then the information is copied to the memory, so you can use some text editor to get X and Y coordinate here. So I put a tab between X and Y coordinate and copy this. And now I close this and go back to the time series definition. So I select number four, and now I can paste X and Y coordinate of the selected cell here. And next, so where it's a K column, so when you right click on this, you can have some instruction on how to input data into the K column. So in this model, so if you want to, we have can have a different K value. So if the K is from 1 to KC, where KC is the number of the vertical water layer in the model, then the model will extract the data for that specific layer. And if you type in K is equal to 0, then the depth average value will be computed and reported. And if you define the number minus 1, then the model will extract the value of minimum, maximum, and the average value of that cell. And if we have some fixed depth, that the elevation will be changed according to the water surface elevation, but because the depth is fixed, so so when the water surface elevation is changing with time, then the actual elevation of the data point extraction location will be changed according to the water surface elevation as well. And if you want to extract the data at a fixed elevation with respect to the datum, then you can specify minus 3. And with the withdraw and return boundary condition, you can also extract the data that is when you use the flow rate for each layer of that boundary at the weighting factors. And so if I want to extract for example, okay, so number one is minus 2, for example, that's a fixed depth. Then in the next column, we for the K, we select a fixed depth or fixed elevation, we need to specify that the depth value or the elevation value to this one. For example, if I want to extract the temperature at the water depth of 1 meter below the surface elevation, then I can put here number one. And the ID for the location, so just put the name, so the, I put in by. And the next column is the path name for the data file that you want to compare with the model. So in this, when you have a data file for each station, you can specify it here by right clicks on this cell and select the corresponding data file, or you can copy and paste the part of the data file to this area. And if you don't have the data file like the station 4 here, so I don't have any data file, I just want to extract the model result for this location, then you can leave this data file blank. And next column, we need to specify what kind of parameter we will want to extract from the model or to want to compare with the data. So right click on this cell again, we have the, we will have the guides, some guidance for the coding of the parameters. So we have different type of parameter here. And if I want to extract the parameter, I can, the code for the temperature is number 2. Okay, so I close this and I put in number 2 here. And This column is for filtering, so you can have a selection for specify how do you want to filter the data. Zero is do not use a filter, and a positive value is the number of hours to use for moving average filter, and number less than zero is the duration in hour to use with the low pass filter. So okay, I don't want any filter, so I put zero here. And this column is a grouping, so you can plot different station in the same plot. So if you want to plot, then in case you want to plot, like I want to compare this also with the first station. Okay, so the second station. Then I put number two here, so the second and the fourth station will be plot in one in the same figures. And if we have different value for the grouping here, then it's when plot in the different figures. And the last column is you want to turn on and turn off the data extraction for that station. So number one is the using that, so turn on, and zero, that means that we will ignore the data extraction. And in this area, we can have some setting for the data extraction. So firstly, this time tolerance between the model and the data. So how many minutes that we will match the model with the data. So in this model, we can have the single layer and the output frequency of 1 hour, so 60 minutes, so I mean, you have that, so 30 minutes. And we can specify the offset of the Julian date, so I keep the phone at zero. And this is the simulation period, so from the calendar dates, that calendar to this calendar date, and we can specify Julian date of the start, so I use day zero, and because we have about 15 days of ramp up, so and the end date, so day 15 is the last day of the model simulation. And when if everything is okay, you can click on okay button. And now we have four time series comparison has been defined, so we are ready to extract the from the model. So to view the plots of the comparison between the model and the data, then we can click on the plot button here. And in this dialog, you can have some option that to automatically generate all the defined plots to a specific folder. And also we can also automatically extract all the data to a text file, so we can use for other purpose. So I just click on OK and leave that. And here is the model comparison for the water surface elevation at the first station. So we have in this plot that the green, the blue solid line are the model prediction, and the dots, the points are the data. Because the model output interval is 1 hour, but the data is four times a day, that means that the duration between the data points is 6 hours. So the lines connection between the data point do not make sense, so that we use the dashed line to connect the data points, but it doesn't mean that the reality is following the dashed lines. So we can turn on and turn off and change the setting of the a Siri as well as for the assist. When we click on the button here, so we have, if we want to have some setting for the data Siri, we can click on the Siri options. And in this area, we can select each data Siri, and we can have some setting for the powers and lights. And we can turn on and turn off the data Siri as well, the assist for the data Siri. We also have some processing on the data power, like we can have low pass filtering, or we can use some kind of transformation, like changing the time or changing the value by scaling and offsetting. And you can also save the setting we have defined for this plot and use for other station by clicking on this button to save the setting. And if we want to have the to load the setting, we can use this button to read the setting. And to export the plots to a graphic file, we can click on this export meta file button. And if we want to extract this data to a data file, we can click on the export data to a file here. And if you want to load a data file from the disk to this plot and to compare with this existing Siri, we can use the import Siri from a file here also. And these two arrows is for navigating between the stations. So to move to the next station, we can click on the next block, or we can also press down button also. So here, when I click on the next block, then we can see the model and the data comparison for the next station. So in this, the second station is the comparison of the temperature. And we have here the model is good for the water surface elevation, but for the temperature and salinity is not well calibrated. So we can see the difference between the model and the data here. So, and to move back to the previous station, we click on this, and want to move next, we click on this one. We remember that we, okay. Okay, sorry. So here the third station that we, the comparison between the model and the data on the salinity. That's the end of the, okay. So that's for the plotting. And if I, the first time I can view the plot and change the settings, and every setting for each plot will be recorded to the model folders. And next time when we click on the plots again, we can generate on the plots and the data files to the model folders. So, okay, firstly, I will. I will go to the folders. So when we right click on this path, the model path will be copied to the memory, so we can move to that. So here's the model folder. So we have some specific folders that the model and the data will be extracted to. So the calibration plot that we expect that the plot will be exact here. So we click on the plot and we check on the to generate automatically the plot and the data file, and we click on OK. And click on OK here. Then on the plot and the data series will be extracted and export to the following folders. So we will now check again, and now we have the plot export for the three stations in this folder. So we can open some graphic viewers to see this, and we can also use this graphic to insert into our report. And now we have one more folders called Calib Export, that on the data series is now export to the text file in the time series format that we looked at before. And next, we will examine the error statistic for the data series. So we click on the report here. And we can turn on and turn off the statistic we want to see. And in the new version of 8.4, we're going to show that have the option to use the files that's already extracted by the model. In the previous version, we every time we want to see plots or the error statistic, the model, the EE tool will need to read the output file from the disk and do the data extraction and comparison. That may be a time consuming. So for the new version, that if you have already extracted the data file to the disk, then you can reuse it. So it's much quicker. So if I turn on, turn off the HTML report, then we will have some statistic report in the old format. So we click on OK. And now we can see that the first one is the EEMS error for the different station. So here we have three stations. We will have EEMS error for each station, and we also have the composite statistic for different type parameter here. So if we have more than one station for one certain parameter, then it's going to combine own station that having that parameter to this area. So we when we close this, we can move to the next statistic. So the second one is the NAT subscript statistic. So we can have the this efficiency index for the water surface elevation is very good here, but for the temperature and salinity is very low. And for the fourth station, that we don't have the data yet, so there's no comparison for this. And click on OK, we will go to the next. It's the R squared, that means that determination coefficient. So we're going to, similar to the NAS subscript, we're going to have root for the water surface elevation. Okay, so, and if we click on this again, but this time we will use the combined error statistic, and we will have HTML reports. And if we want to generate the report to the local disk, we can also check on this. So we click on OK. And on the error statistics will be exported to the this folder. So we will move to this Calib stats. And this is the HTML format. So we double click and we can open it in a web browser, or we can also import that into a Word document or the Excel file. So here we then have a different station ID parameters, the type, the layer of data extraction. We can have the date and time of data extraction. We have a number of data pairs, and we have the average of the observation and average of the model, and mean and max also. And we can have a mass error here, root mean square. We can have NAS and subscripts efficiency index, and we can have the R square, the coefficient of determination. Okay, so that's this for the time series plots. So the same definition for the time series plot we can use for the correlation plots. So to define the correlation, okay, so I will copy. So when I select the first three station, I can click on Ctrl C to copy it to the memory. And I can, for example, if I type in zero here, we don't have anything, but we number three, we can have three blank lines for the three station. And select the first cell and I press Ctrl V, and I can paste the station definition to this form, and I also want to extract from day zero, skipping the ramming up periods. So, and all the column here are exactly the same as the time series extraction form. So I click on OK, and now I click on the plots, and OK for the first time. Then I will have the correlation plot between the model, the data here, the observation, and the model prediction here. So we will have the rest points and the data pairs between the data and the model. And the blue line here are the linear regression line, and the solid black line here are the perfect lines, that means one-to-one model to data correlation. So in this case, we can have on those that the correlation coefficient between the model and the data are good, we have the regression coefficient of almost 0.98 here, but we can clearly see that for some low waters, the model underpredicts the water surface elevation. But for high water, is considered that is suitable. But for low water, is very underpredicted. So that means that if you have the good correlation coefficient, but doesn't mean that the model is well calibrated with the data. If we don't compare with the perfect line, the solid black line here. And similar for this plot, we can go move to the next station by clicking on this button. So here for the temperature, and we can see that the data is more scattering. And similar, we can move to the salinity also. Okay, so when you move to the last station, then the form will be closed, or if you want to close the form at any time, you just click on this button. Okay, so this is the single layer model, so we don't have any vertical profile. And Now we move to the, and we don't have a high frequency also, so we will move to the flux comparison. So move to the model. So here we will, next we will compare the flow chart to this cross section. So the red line here and the and also finally we will compare the sheet track, glory track for this model. And to compare the flow charts for the bay. So firstly, we can check the model. So we in this annotation, we can load the chance text. So we click on annotation and we browse to the chance text file. So the, or we can define. Okay. So firstly, I will define a chance text to this one. So I use the polylight tool here. So I click on this to activate the polylight tool. So and then in this toolbar, I click on the draw polylight, and I will draw a first point and the second point here. And when you have 2 points, then you can right click to stop drawing. And I will name that chance 6 one, and okay. And then we can save this chance 6 to the this. So we click on save polyline, and I will save in the default model analysis folder with name chance 6, and the file format will be P2D. That two-dimensional polyline format. So I save to this. And similar for the cruise part, we can define the cruise part, or we simply we have the part defined before. So I can load the cruise check. So should be in the calibration data, and we have a cruise check here. So open it, and we can define the format for the line and check on the global view as well as the view for this data file. And here we have the cruise checks that we will extract the flow for this chance, and then finally we extract the salinity and temperature along this cruise check. Okay, so we can close this P2D and go back to the calibration tool. And firstly, we need to define the flux comparison by clicking on this button. And we have a form, so we have one chance set. So we leave the number of time series one. Actually, that's the number of chance sets. And the ID here, we can put any name for this one. That's the name of the chance set. And the flux line, that means that the chance set file we have just defined. So we can right click on this and browse for the chance set file we just defined. So in the analysis folder, chance set.p2d, open it, and now it's populated to this. And this one is the data file for the observation of flow across that chance set. And the parameter here, and if we don't know which parameter that, we can right click on that, and we can see that for the flow at the chart, that the parameter cost is 0. So that 0 is correct. And filtering, and that multi application factors that for some kind of unit conversion. So we keep this to cubic meter per second. So I can use a factor of one, grouping one is for using, and the time tolerance is 30 minutes. So, okay, so we click on okay to close this. And now we can plot to extract the data and plot. So we click on plot. Okay. So we can see the model. We extract the time series and load the data and plot here. So we can have the blue lines, the flows extracted using the transect we just defined. And the red line are the data observation, so we can see the good matching between the model and the data for the flow discharge. Okay, so now I will close this and we move to the last cruise plus comparison tool. So if we want to comparison between the model and the data along a cruise track, we can click on define and edit here. And we similar to the other form, we have the first column here are the cruise number ID. So we have only one track, but we measure both salinity and temperature. So we can define separately into two tracks, but we can use exactly the same data file. But the only difference is the data column that we see in the file format. So the first check will be the salinity, and the second check will be temperature. And the second column here is the type of the data format will be used. And number one is the USDF format, and number two is the DSI format. That the format I have described in the slide before. And with the USDS format, we also need to specify the date here, but for the DSI format, we don't need to put anything, because the first column of the five column is the time in Julian date. And the data file for each check here, we can browse for this. And the parameter, so similar, we can right click to see, and the code for salinity is number one, and the code for the temperature is number two, as we can see here. And flag to use or not. So here we want to see both track. And with the USDS format, we also need to browse for the location of the each station along the track. But for the DSI format, we have the second and the third column are X and Y, so we don't need to do anything. So now we click on OK, and we are ready to extract the data. And if we want to see, we click on the plot here, and there are two options. If you have multiple layers model and multiple layers data, we can plot the data and the model as a cruise profile. But in this example, we have a single layer model, and also we have only one depth data at a fixed depth of 0.5 meters below the water surface. So we can select the second option, the cruise line plot. So we click on OK. And here we can have the model and the data comparison for the time and for the distance. But in this plot, we compare by time, and I just load a setting that we defined before. So blue is plot for salinity. Yeah. And then we can have now is the model is the blue line and the data are the red lines. And we so have here the number of data pairs and the R square between the model and the data. And we can click on this to move to the next plot. And that is the comparison of the gray text for the temperature. We're gonna so load the setting for this. So I load the setting. And we then have the plot formatted and similar results of the temperature for the cross. So, okay, I think that we can move to the last session is a Q&A session. Okay, so if you have any questions, you can raise your hand or you can type in the Q&A session. So do you have any questions or comments, please raise your hands or type in. Okay, any questions or comments? Okay, if you don't have any questions and comments, then we can close our webinar today. And we will prepare the video for this webinar and post it online. When it's ready, we will notify you by emails so you can view it. So thank you very much for joining us in the webinar. And we hope we will have more chance to see you in next webinar. So thank you very much again and goodbye.